I think it's very appropriate that this conference on radical Islam is taking place here at the Academy of Sciences in Budapest. For one of your most illustrious corresponding members, the Turkologist Arminius Bambury, was one of the first in 1877 to coin the phrase pan-Islam, by which he meant the activities then occurring in parts of the Islamic world which called on Muslims to unite to resist the Christian powers of Europe. It's worthwhile, I think, spending a little time analysing this movement and the developing Western response to it, since it helps us put into perspective our current predicament with regard to the radical Islam. As a traveller in the Ottoman Empire and in Central Asia, and a confidant of the ultimate Ottoman Sultan Caliph, Abdulhamid, Vanbury was in a unique position to monitor the attempts by what Glastonian liberals called him Abdul the Damned, and his attempts to mobilize Muslim opinion in his quest to roll back the seemingly steady encroachment of the European powers, especially Russia, France, Britain, and we shouldn't forget the Netherlands, on the territories of the Dar al-Islam, from North Africa to the East Indies and from Central Asia to East Africa. As an Anglophile and a Russophobe, Vanbury was happy to pass on for a small consideration to the British government, who dubbed him the Dervish of Windsor, for in fact he used to go there to brief Queen Victoria on what's happening in the Balkans and Central Asia. He managed to glean information on pan-Islamist activities from the Sultan and his ministers, the Sires, Pashas and Sheikhs whom he met on his travels, and passed them on to the British. Why? Because Britain was worried of the threat that Ottoman pan-Islamist agitation might pose, along with the machinations of the French, the Russians and the Germans, to Britain's hold on India with its large Muslim population and the routes to it through the Muslim countries of the greater Middle East. Vanbury was one of a number of intelligence agents and controllers dotted at strategically important locations around the world. Often these were British Indian Army officers, the founders of Britain's current security service, who kept track of the movement of what they regarded as Muslim malcontents east and west of Suez and Istanbul. They did a pretty good job of this with minimal resources, thwarting plot after plot by small but dedicated groups of Diabandis, Wahhabis, and various Muslim fraternities, often in cahoots with Abdulhamid and his young Turk successors, and thus protecting the security of Britain and the peoples for which he was responsible. Sometimes punitive military expeditions were required against aggressive Islamist movements which had torn the heart out of lands and peoples, such as the Mahdi and his Khalifa in Sudan, the mad Mullah of Somaliland, the Hindustani fanatics and the Fakir of Ippi on the northwest front of India, and not forgetting the Wahhabis of Najd. All these areas, of course, are still with us today and are areas of concern. And we should remember that the Ottoman Empire's war against Britain and the other Entente powers, France and Russia, between 1914 and 18, was officially a jihad, intended with German help to raise the green standard of pan-Islamist revolt among the Muslim populations of the Entente empires, thus fatally undermining their critical war effort in Europe. It failed, as did the post-war Russia-German attempt with Turkish pan-Islamists to carry out Lenin's grandiloquent call to set the East ablaze, believing that by sweeping away the European empires he could knock the props from under capitalism and bring about the revolution of the proletariat throughout Europe. It was based on his erroneous analysis that imperialism was the last stage of capitalism. With the abolition of the Ottoman Sultanate in 1922 and the Caliphate 2 years later by Mustafa Kemal Ataturk, the Indian-led caliphate agitation faded away, and pan-Islamism became in the interwar years the distant dream of would-be caliphs, such as Fuad of Egypt, Amanullah of Afghanistan, and for a brief moment, Hussein of the Hejaz. Even the latter's successor as the keeper of the holy places, Abdulaziz of Saudi Arabia, entertained schemes of Islamic unity and used his representatives, including fellow travelers and fixers such as Harry St. John Filby, the father of the more infamous Kim, to promote these ideas at the periodic conventions on this subject held in such places as Cairo, Mecca, Jerusalem, and Geneva. At the same time, a new and more sophisticated brand of pan-Islamist nationalism emerged, such as Hassan al-Banna's Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, with a more bottom-up organizational approach to the regeneration of Muslim peoples and the world, in opposition to the Western-inspired secular nationalism, which seemed to be taking root in the Dar al-Islam. It was noticeable that while Britain and France were content to monitor these developments, and sometimes co-opt Islamists into their system of influence and control in the greater Middle East, the totalitarian powers, Italy, Germany, and the Soviet Union, often tried to use them against the Western European powers. But it was the Second World War which altered respective power balance between Europe, which fell within the traditional Dar al-Harb in Islamic thought, and the Dar al-Islam. The war resulted in the division of a prostrated Europe by the two new superpowers, the Soviet Union and the United States, thus plodding steps towards the realization of Monet's dream of a united federal European state through an economic recovery, partly dependent upon imported Muslim labor, and the subsequent recession of European power from the Dar al-Islam and the emergence of independent Muslim states from Morocco to Indonesia, whether of a nationalist or Islamist bent, sometimes a fusion of the two. Added to this potent mix was the rocket fuel of vast oil revenues from the 1960s, which enabled a varied array of pocket dictators, petty princelings, and radical Islamists in the Middle East to institute their new jihad by stealth against the West, in between conducting their own deadly squabbles with each other. I think it's no accident that OPEC chose Vienna as its headquarters. It was a symbolic signal of intent to make good the failure of the Turks to take the city, the capital of the Holy Roman Emperor, in 1683. The oil price rise shocks of 1973 and 1979, which sent Western economies into depression, were intended, as one Arab oil minister put it at the time, as revenge for Poitiers, which of course was another Muslim fleet in 732 AD, this time at the hands of the Frankish general Charles Martel. These vast oil revenues may have underwritten the modernization of many Middle Eastern states, but they also funded terrorism against the West and allowed the Saudis in particular to fund the growing network of global Islamic organizations, such as the Organization of the Islamic Conference, and thus spread their fierce Wahhabi faith. It was clear to those few who had the courage to point it out at the time that oil weapons corollary, the investment of huge petrodollar balances in the West, was intended by those who wielded to take by sap what they could not yet take by storm, because of the West's continuing military superiority. It was inadvertently confirmed by the well-known Sheikh Yusuf al-Qaradawi, who unconvincingly denies his involvement with the Muslim Brotherhood, when he said on Qatari television in 2007, and I quote, "The conquest of Rome, the conquest of Italy and Europe, means that Islam will return to Europe once again. But must this conquest necessarily be through war? No. There's such a thing as a peaceful conquest. The peaceful conquest has foundations in this religion, and therefore I expect that Islam will conquer Europe without resorting to the sword or fighting. It will do so by dawah, proselytizing Islam and ideology." So what has been the reaction of the West to this pan-Islamist jihad by stealth? It can be summed up in two words, in my opinion, confusion and appeasement. Confusion is at the heart of the Western response to radical Islam. First of all, there's confusion over national and European identities, the sustained assault by the Euro-establishment driven by the status doctrines of the liberal left, and the very concept of the European nation state, all of course in the name of a unified Europe, has not only undermined the sovereignty of those states, but the confidence of their governments and citizens in their own national and cultural identities. It's not surprising then they're not able to show the immigrants, Muslim or otherwise, what it is to be British, French, German or Hungarian, and they expect to be citizens of the multicultural European Union. Secondly, the Euro elite has been so perplexed by the sheer number and variety of Muslim communities, some living separate state-funded lives in European cities, that their centralizing antennae have sought out larger and better organized Muslim organizations to act as go-betweens. That many of these organizations are run by Islamists, especially the Muslim Brotherhood, with the Ramadan family having a near monopoly of this business, with their own conflicting Sharia agenda for Europe, which does not represent that of many Muslims, doesn't seem to occur to many of the Eurocrats. If it has belatedly occurred to some of them, they, especially on the left, are happy with it, since this red-green alliance furthers their mutual aim of bringing about the triumph of a hybrid form of Islamic communism, or so they hope. Lastly, there's been an intellectual confusion, some might say a mental block on the part of Western policymakers with regard to the links between Islam, Islamism, and terrorism. One would have thought that the growing catalogue of terrorist outrages perpetrated by Muslims, not only on Westerners, but largely on other Muslims in the last 40 years or so, would have led Western governments to make the connection. But no, just the opposite has occurred. Just as the CIA denied the Soviet Union was behind much of the terror international during the Cold War, successive US presidential administrations since the Islamist revolution in Iran in 1979 and the Mujahideen's successful fight against the Soviets in Afghanistan have denied there's any link between terrorism, Islamism, and Islam. As Bill Clinton's counter-terror czar put it, and I quote, "The misuse of Islamic political rhetoric should not cause us to confuse in our own minds terrorism and Islam. What we're talking about is terrorism, and not political ideologies, and certainly not Islam." Not even 9/11 managed to shift this mindset, where George Bush managed to declare war on a tactic rather than the organization, Al-Qaeda, that carried out the attacks on New York and Washington. This intellectual confusion has been at the heart, I think, of the failure of the West, led by the United States, to come up with a coherent strategy to take on and defeat radical Islam. In this case, it's due to a desire to appease both their Muslim constituents and influential Muslim powers, a sure sign of submission by Western governments. It's enshrined in the novel commandment that thou shalt distance Islam from Islamism, which has been adhered to firmly by Western leaders and their bureaucrats after every terrorist attack since 9/11. This has led to some awkward moments when Westerners seem to arrogate to themselves the right to decide what is or what is not Islamic, which has had both the grey-haired divines of Al-Aqsa in Cairo and the woolly-headed Taliban in the mountains of Afghanistan all shaking their heads in disbelief. Western leaders no doubt believe they're engaging in a clever piece of psychological warfare which will divide bad Muslims from good Muslims, especially among their own communities, but they end up offending all Muslims through their presumptuous rhetoric. Their latest wheeze is to refer to the so-called Islamic State in the Levant, or ISIL, by the slightly comical acronym Daesh, imagining that by dropping the reference in English to matters Islamic, they will avoid offending Muslim sensibilities. I suspect this has been done at the behest of their various favorite Muslim community leaders and or influential monarchical regimes in the Middle East, who are both adept at calling the tune of Western capitals. Western governments have been pursuing the politics of the preemptive cringe towards the Islamic world since the oil price shocks of the 1970s, which seems to have resulted in their Pavlovian-like accession to Muslim demands and a fawning desire to please. The multivitamin-like dog biscuit of oil, gas, petrodollar investment, and lucrative arms contracts have made the West especially dependent upon the chronically unstable regimes of the greater Middle East. Instead of walking softly and carrying a big stick in defense of their interests, however, successive Western governments have allowed themselves to be kicked from pillar to post, excuse my mixing my metaphors here, are scheming Middle Eastern regimes or exiled individuals who've sought outside intervention to secure an advantage in their ongoing war with each other and the West. In other words, we have become parties to others' disputes. We franchise the control and defense of Western interests to other local, regional, and international players who have, of course, their own often conflicting but definitely anti-Western interests. This helps, I think, explain the hesitancy and contradictions in Western policy and strategy, such as it exists, and the proclivity to appeasement as the default operating mode. I think Western appeasement of Islamism has reached a new low under the US President Obama, who by his unilateral and some might say double-dealing behavior has single-handedly managed to divide and weaken the West. First of all, there were his starry-eyed speeches in Cairo and Istanbul, intended to flatter and seduce the Islamic world. Then there was his reaching out of the hand of friendship to the Islamist regime in Tehran. Both of these naive appeals had the diametrically opposite effect to that intended, namely boosting the morale and cause of the Sunni Islamists in Cairo and Istanbul and being ignored by their Shiite opposite numbers in Tehran. Both groups, however, regarded Obama's proffered hand of friendship as evidence of the palsied nature of American power. Second of all, there was Obama's eager dumping of Hosni Mubarak in 2011 in his closing up to Morsi and the Muslim Brotherhood. It was demonstrated to America's other long-term allies in the region that they could no longer rely on US support in the crisis that was engulfing the Middle East. This has done real damage to US standing and has considerably reduced US and Western influence over the calculations of key actors who have looked to themselves and other external powers to safeguard their conflicting interests, thus further destabilizing the region. Obama's blunder has not been made good by the subsequent rowing back of US and Western support for what they see as moderate Islamism, which under Morsi proved anything but. There's been a reluctant acceptance of the fact that there might be some life left yet in the old authoritarian regime in Egypt. Third, there was Obama's overweening desire to go down in history as the US president who solved the Iran problem, which has led him to engage in the most duplicitous diplomacy, especially towards his Western European allies. As far as one can tell, this has only smoothed Islamist Iran's path to acquiring a nuclear weapon, something Obama pledged not to allow, and will only succeed in nuclearizing the wider Middle East. There's no reason for doubting Iranian President Rouhani's description of the very peculiar comprehensive joint plan of action, which is neither an agreement nor a treaty. Note also that it was drawn up in that capital surrender, Vienna. When Rouhani said, it's a plan for the lifting of sanctions and the modernization of Iran's nuclear program. Again, all kinds of good things are claimed for the plan by the Obama administration by way of concealing this surrender to Iran. In particular, that it would empower the moderates, that's to say Rafsanjani and Rouhani in Tehran in time for the next elections, and thus miraculously normalize relations between the Islamist regime and the West. Unfortunately, this perennial Western quest for moderates in Iran, as elsewhere in the Middle East, falls down in the case of Iran, where Rouhani has set a new record for public executions and has cracked down on civil rights. Moreover, he has increased Iran's aid for the embattled Assad regime in Syria. He's organizing, funding, and arming new Shiite militias in Iraq and the Yemen. He's actively trying to undermine the pro-Western government in Bahrain. Fourth, you have Obama's dilettante approach to diplomacy, which can be seen as in his quick abandonment of his pursuit of the two-state solution in Israel-Palestine. But he realized that it was all too difficult. This has been disguised by its periodic peevishness towards Israel and Netanyahu. The subsequent political vacuum has been increasingly filled by the Islamist rejectionist factions in the West Bank and Gaza, and has led to a deteriorating security situation there and in Israel proper. Something more serious has happened in Libya, where far from leaving behind, Obama simply sat on his posterior, while Islamist militias have filled the vacuum left by Gaddafi and NATO. It's interesting to note that it's fallen to France to take the lead, against the Islamist menace in North Africa, and they're also spearheading the EU drive to recognise a Palestinian state. This is all the result of Obama's failure to stand up to the Islamists. It has to be remembered that it was his sabotage with George W. Bush's Status of Forces Agreement, which led to the withdrawal of all but 1,000 US troops from Iraq by 2013. This allowed the Sunni Islamist organization, Al-Qaeda of Iraq, which then split and mutated into Jabhat al-Fatah and ISIL, to regroup and recover from the hammering they received from Petraeus' surge in 2007 and 8. Obama's blunder forced the Shiite regime in Baghdad to look to Iran for support against ISIL, thus increasing Iran's footprint in Iraq. When Obama was forced to try and make good his mistake, he had to eat humble pie last year and try and persuade Baghdad and Tehran to allow US troops and air power to help out again in Iraq. His later lukewarm response is summed up by his stated aim to degrade and contain ISIL, not destroy it, mind you. In accordance with this, US airstrikes have been largely restricted to supporting Kurdish forces fighting ISIL in northern Iraq along the Syria-Turkey border around Kobani. And this is aligned the US and the West with Iran against ISIL in Iraq and increasingly in eastern Syria. At the same time that this is happening, Obama and the West are meant to be supporting, along with their Gulf Arab allies, those elusive Sunni moderates, Islamist or secular, in their fight against both ISIL and the Assad regime. But Obama effectively undermined this policy by 2013 by allowing any non-military aid to go to these moderate groups and not enforcing his own red lines against Assad's multiple use of chemical weapons against his civilian population. By his inaction, Obama has ceded the initiative in Syria to an unholy alliance of Iran, Hezbollah, the Iraqi Shiite militias, and now Russia, who are all bent on keeping Assad in power, whatever they might say in the way of soothing words about the future transition to a gullible West. Moreover, Putin's swaggering military intervention contrasts sharply with Obama's obvious distaste in having to take any action at all. This underlines for all to see in the region Russia's seeming rise at the expense of the United States and the West. So let me wrap up here. Obama and the West's dithering in Iraq and Syria has allowed Assad and the new caliph Ibrahim to not only survive but prosper in a sort of Faustian pact. Both rely on outside support, but whereas Assad is confined to Western Syria, the new caliph has, like his Ottoman predecessor, Abdulmutallab, sought to reinvigorate long simmering Muslim revolts from North Africa to Afghanistan, from the Caucasus to Yemen and the Horn of Africa. By doing so, his advance is claimed to be restoring the caliphate. The failure of Obama and the West and the UN Security Council to deal with the multiplying crises in the Dar al-Islam is now being felt in Europe and further afield, as migrants in their millions flood into a continent without effective borders or means of coping with this human deluge. Genre Spy's 1973 vision has proved truly prophetic. The whole future of the EU and even Europe is now in question. The iron logic of the Euro establishment's confused and appeasing approach to radical Islam, especially within Europe, seems to point towards Europe's eventual acceptance of its submission to Islamism in the near future. Michel Houellebecq's vision of a Sharia enforcing government in France could happen sooner than we think if the Euro elite are allowed to have their way. I hope the growing revulsion of large numbers of Europeans being slaughtered in their own streets by the increasingly emboldened Islamists will bring to power political parties who are prepared to take whatever measures are necessary to roll back radical Islam and safeguard our security. If they fail at this, then we could be well looking at the widespread breakdown of law and order in Europe as Islamism infects the large and growing Muslim populations of Europe and turns them against the non-Muslim populations. And it becomes the case of every man for himself. Thank you.
It's been a very enlightening and interesting day. There are many issues at the moment that would have me make a special trip to Budapest, much as I love this city, but this is one a really burning issue. And watching from Australia this past year, the news accounts and the TV pictures of what seemed to us like Europe's borders basically collapsing, maybe all the more, I think, pertinent that we came here. I'm just going to offer you two observations from an Australian perspective, which I think might help inform this question of where we take this now, what we do in response to this. The first point is really to say that this is a global problem. It's a global issue of enormous significance and importance. I was sort of called up earlier today when one of the speakers sort of compared this to a dispute in South Tyrol, which he said had been settled rather peacefully. I can't remember that figuring as an issue in Australia, maybe it was before my time. No, this is a much bigger issue. The last time I was here with my wife Rebecca, this was almost exactly a year ago in Budapest. And I must admit, we spent the first 48 hours of our visit glued to the television rather than get out and see the city. Why was that? Because we were watching quite horrifying pictures live from Sydney of a siege in Martin Place in the heart of the city, where customers at a Lindt cafe, which is basically a chocolate shop, were being held hostage by a man who displayed Islamic flags at the window. That went on for a while. Three people were killed in that, two people plus the man who held it up. And that was a moment, I think, for Australia when this issue came home. In Australia, terrorism is almost synonymous with Islam. And I don't understand this idea that people want to perpetuate that it's part of all religions and there's terrorism of all sorts. In the Australian experience, recent experience, there's only one form of terrorism, and that's terrorism caused by, motivated by Islam. Since 2001, since the 9/11 attack, there have been roughly 130 Australians killed by terrorists. Every one of those killed by Islamic terrorists. We've had Australians killed by Al-Qaeda-inspired attacks like 9/11. We've had the largest number, 88 Australians killed by Jamaat Ismailia, who bombed a nightclub in Bali, you may remember, and more recently, Islamic State-inspired terrorism. There was one incident quite recently where a 15-year-old boy shot dead a police accountant as he was emerging from the police station. This 15-year-old boy had been radicalised and obtained a gun from somebody in his local mosque. So this really is a serious, serious problem. And in a country with a very peaceful history like Australia's, it's come as a great shock. On this question of immigration, which I think we've been skirting around today, we have to get to this central question. Is immigration exacerbating this problem for the West? On immigration, I note that in France, the percentage of the population that was born overseas, i.e. the immigrant population, the latest figures I have is 8.5%. In Holland it's 10.7%, Britain 12.4%, Germany 12.9%, Canada 20.6%, Australia, the latest figures this year, 28% of the population born overseas. 28% of Australian residents are in effect migrants. That's the highest proportion in Australia since the gold rush of the late 19th century. And yet, immigration as such is not really a political issue in Australia at all. A survey recently found that 27% of people thought that they didn't like the government's hand in immigration. They thought that the number of migrants coming was too high. And yet Spain, a similar survey, said 77% people found it a problem, 73% in the UK. So we have this marvellous situation where we have a very, very high proportion of immigrants. We have a high migration intake every year, and yet the public is largely happy with it. Why think because we're a country from the New World which has relied on immigration, particularly since the Second World War, to fuel economic growth and to help the country grow in prosperity, we're used to it. And more than that, I think Australia has put in place some fairly rigorous policies to make sure the sort of migrants we get are the right kind of migrants. It's always been linked pretty closely to employment options, the view being that you come there to work. We have a very high proportion of our migrants, for instance, are university graduates, highly skilled people. But in recent years, in the last 15 years or so, this idea that we could choose who came to the country has been challenged by what we call unauthorised arrivals or illegal immigrants, as some call them. We started to see there were a very small number of people arrived by boat after the Vietnam War, maybe 2,000 at most, arrived on our shores by boat and they were processed. At the start of this century, around 2001, larger numbers started to come, and it became a challenge for the government what to do about it. John Howard, the then leader of the Liberal Party, who was in power, took a very firm stance on this and decided that we couldn't allow these people to settle in Australia, to come onto shore, because once they were on shore, they would have to have their applications processed, it would be the subject of court challenges, and this would go on and on, as indeed it did. So we went for this policy of what we call the Pacific Solution, where the government basically set up, paid neighbouring governments to set up processing centres so that people who came, they wouldn't be in any danger, they'd be sent to somewhere like PNG or Nauru, where their applications would be processed. This was John Howard's phrase, which I think is probably one of the most powerful political phrases in Australian history, was when he said, look, we will show compassion to people that come from difficult circumstances, but we will decide who comes to this country and the circumstances in which they come. And that had enormous resonance with the Australian population and was overwhelmingly a positive for him, although by and large it's been a bipartisan policy. Move fast forward to 2007, the election of a Labour government under Kevin Rudd. There was a lot of sentiment around amongst the lobbies on the left that we were being too hard on asylum seekers. We had to do something to soften our policy. And the Rudd government decided to ease the policy so that people would be let out of detention centres into the community, various other things. The Age, which is used to be a very strong newspaper in Melbourne, but it's now, we call it the Green Left Daily, we call it, they put an editorial out that said, an era of shame has ended. You know, and Australia has now got beyond this era of shame of releasing people into the community. The result of that was an immediate reaction by the people smugglers who were bringing people in through Indonesia. These people had come from the Arab world, they'd come from Afghanistan, they'd come from Iraq. They filtered into Indonesia because they could get in without a visa. And they'd then come down the coast join these fishing boats. They arrive on Australian shores in very dangerous circumstances, having lost their passports on the way, so there'd be no way of identifying them. And this, first it was one boat, and then it was two, and before you knew it, there were three or four a week. So over a period of 2008, 2009, until 2013 when the government changed, about 50,000 people arrived that way. About 2,000, or almost 2,000 of them died en route. So you probably basically had a 2% chance of being killed coming that route. It was plainly dangerous. Once the Liberal government came into force of power into 2013, it was widely said in the media, look, they won't be able to stop the boats, you know, this is happening. But the other government came Navy, if they couldn't protect our shores from an invasion of this sort, what could they do? And they set in place quite a well thought through and strategic policy of turning back boats when it was safe to do so. They bought covered life rafts and various things so the boats would be intercepted, they'd be boarded by Australian Navy personnel, turned around and sent back. If the boats were dangerous, and what was happening actually, I think we've seen this in the Mediterranean too, was the boats were being deliberately sabotaged so that the Australian rescue services had to rescue these people to bring them ashore. What happened in those circumstances? They'd be put in a sealed orange safe boat with enough fuel to get back to Indonesia. This had an almost immediate effect, and the government came to power in September of 2013. By December, the flow of boats had stopped, and since that point there have been no successful landings in Australia. The offshore detention centres still have a number of, I think somewhere around 1,500 detainees in them. These people are in limbo. They can find nowhere to take them as asylum seekers. Australia certainly is not going to do so, hard as it seems, but that has proved the only way to stop the traffic. I think what we've learned is that the people smuggling, traffickers who were managing this trade are highly sophisticated, armed with mobile phones, very often linked to asylum sympathisers in Australia who would be coordinating with them and giving them all the local information and so forth. And to break that model, break that business model, because that's what it is, they were charging something like $10,000 or $15,000 a head for the short sea journey from Indonesia to a Christmas Island off Australia, which is three or four times the first class airfare. So it was a big money-making business for Indonesian crime syndicates. To break that model takes absolute firmness and resolve, and it means that the government has to send out the message that there, under no circumstances will anybody be allowed to settle in Australia. It was backed up with television advertising campaigns in Afghanistan, Pakistan and elsewhere to say this is the case. And that did it. Now, I think when we started to see what was happening in Europe, well, I guess 2 years ago, sort of came to our notice really that the same boat traffic was happening, it just seemed self-evident that unless there was concerted, decisive action by the European Union on this to set up some kind of offshore processing centre in North Africa where people could be taken, you know, so to ensure that nobody's going to be put in danger by being sent back to their country, they would have their claims processed. And unless there was that concerted action, the number would only grow and grow and grow. So I think this summer, although it was horrifying to watch the numbers come, it was no surprise really, because this is the way the trade works. And then to hear Angela Merkel's comment about a million, just seemed absolutely crazy to us that this was going to be putting the sugar on the table, if you like, that would attract more people, as indeed it did. So I think, just in summary, I'd just say, well, look, as an Australian, I feel a lot of sympathy with Hungary, as you've taken here, and the emphasis on sovereignty. And sovereignty here, I know, is very important for different reasons, because of your history. The exerting your own sovereignty is crucially important. In Australia, that's also what the government did. It called its protection, its patrolling of the waters was known as Operation Sovereign Borders. That's what we were trying to protect. And it, today, that's a controversial idea that many countries should operate sovereign rights of that sort. We are in this age of deracinated internationalism in which we're all supposed to be citizens of the world and which borders don't matter. But I think the lessons of the past 10 years in Australia is that borders do matter, they're crucially important. And once you lose control of your borders, then you lose control of your country and your culture. And I'll just go back to those statistics, because I think this is important. Australia is now, and I use this word advisedly, I take everybody's, I agree with much of what's been said about the word multicultural. It is a problematic word, one that I understand why it's problematic. In Australia, for historical reasons, I think it means something slightly different. But in Australia, 87% of people in the recent survey said that Australia was a better country for being a multicultural country. I can qualify that later if anybody wants to ask what we mean by multicultural. We've done that with 28% of our population being migrants. So it is possible to be a country that embraces people from other lands, and welcomes them in, and gives them a new start in life, and yet protect your borders. And I think that's the lesson which we have to pass on.
I think the first measures are to identify the problem, and the problem which I hope I address in my talk was to deal with, to cut through the confusion in Western thinking about the threat we face. If we do that, that will help us, I think, in the abandonment of appeasement, which is leading us to perdition. This requires resolve on the part of Europeans and Americans. They cannot continue to ignore the threat that's in front of them, that's leading to the slaughter of their own citizens and Muslims within the Middle East. The threat of Islamism has to be addressed. Now, as far as I'm concerned, it's sort of, once you've established your first principles, then you can work out what's going to be effective. As far as Europe is concerned, it must regain control of its borders, whether they're external or internal. That is vital to our security. Security services cannot act without these establishing control over the frontiers. Second of all, within Europe, there has to be, if I can say, a radical approach to militant Islam. The offenders need to be dealt with very sternly indeed. They're a threat to us, they're a threat to their own communities. Moving to the Middle East, the core of this problem, we cannot leave it to fester. Our interests are directly affected by what's going on, hence the huge migration into Europe. This is a result of Western failure policy in Libya and in Syria and Iraq, and it's having catastrophic effects not only on the region, but on the world. In Libya, we must do what we should have done after we deposed Gaddafi, which was to essentially back up a UN trusteeship regime, which would actually establish a sort of governance in Libya. Because Libya had never really known any proper governmental institutions under the Gaddafi regime. He was the mad pasha of Tripoli, who ran it as a family, concern. When he went, any sort of governing control of Libya went as well. So it was up to the UN, who established the independence of Libya in 1951 with the help of Britain and the United States and France, to do exactly the same thing. And those three countries should have been involved with that. And you even find British diplomats who were involved with it at the time, shaking their heads and saying, this is what the UN, Britain, France, the United States should have done. They failed to do it. So you turned Libya into this vacuum, this res nullius, which has been filled, of course, by the Islamist groups. The same thing in Syria and Iraq. The problem arose as a result of, as I hope I brought out, Obama's retreat from Iraq in 2011. That's the key date. It's not 2003 and the Anglo-American invasion of Iraq. It's 2011. We did the hard miles. We beat the insurgency in Anbar, and if the Americans and the British had retained sufficient troop numbers there, then AQI wouldn't have resurged, split into Jaish al-Fatah and ISIL, and spread across the border of Syria to northern Iraq and so on. So, and it's, you know, it's an invidious task for Western powers. Why should young Western men pour out their blood in the sands of Iraq and Syria? But it's necessary. Sorry, this makes me very emotional because of missed opportunities. People that have been killed trying to establish some sort of order in the Badlands, or at least to keep the outlaws, because Abu Bakr, you know, the Caliph Ibrahim, as he calls himself, is one in a long line of outlaws operating the deserts of eastern Syria. You can just go back to the Second World War, same thing with the implosion of the Vichy French regime in Syria. Same thing happened. The British had to put down these revolts in eastern Syria. It has a tradition, as does Anbar, of insurgency. Now, if people would know their history, they would see that these things happen again and again. If you like, control, even minimum control, is lifted. And this is what has happened again. I don't think we should overestimate the ability of the Caliph and his band of merry men in Raqqa. Because he very much fits into the desert bandit mold, but he has greater claims. But in the past, we have seen these caliphs and these Batthyánis rise and fall. There's no reason why it shouldn't happen again, but it requires Western engagement in defense of Western interests, along with their allies in the region, like Egypt and other countries, and to prevent also those countries in the Gulf that have a very ambivalent attitude towards the funding of anti-Assad groups and so on. So it needs action, and in Churchill's words, action this day.
Who have been funding a lot of the
Salafi groups operating against Assad will not take these refugees from Syria. I'm pretty sure that these European governments won't even ask the Gulf Arabs to do this. They would rather take the strain themselves because they know what the answer will be. Because as has been the case before, particularly with regard to the Palestinian diaspora, you know, some Palestinians have been taken, a lot not. I mean, the camps are still full in Gaza. I mean, you could say right from the beginning that they should have been dispersed throughout the Arab world, but a lot of these Arab countries didn't want to take them. But, and I think this is a real problem for Europe, the fact that we do not say to the Saudis and the other Gulf Arabs, look, you've helped cause this problem in Syria and Iraq. You help us, you know, solve it, particularly with addressing the real problem of refugees. The Jordanians have been very good at this. They've set up camps, and I have a Jordanian officer at the moment who's doing his research paper with me, who's writing exactly on this question. And the strains that we put on Jordanian society, with a huge number of refugees that they have in the camps, and for instance, the UN camp has opened borders itself. So in other words, they can all migrate to Amman, rent a flat, and of course, because the price of flats for ordinary Jordanians will sky high. Turkey, I think, is a real big question mark. I mean, a lot of these refugees are coming through Turkey and to hopping on ferries and other craft to the Greek islands. What are the Turks doing about this? What I can't get over is the way that in Merkel, instead of saying to Erdogan, you must get control of these refugee flows, instead Merkel feels that she needs to bribe Erdogan to actually cooperate. In other words, we'll fast track your accession to the EU, we'll give you billions of pounds or euros to address this problem. We know a lot of that money will not get to the refugee camps. And it's not dealing with the problem. It's just appeasement, essentially. It is what I call the preemptive cringe, which has a danger of becoming a permanent submission, actually. That a lot of the riots in Arab cities, and European cities, occur on Friday, tells us an awful lot about what's going on in the mosque and what the preachers are saying. That is where the problem needs to be directly addressed by the Muslim communities in the ghettos of European cities we're talking about, but also in the big Arab cities in particular. What we're seeing actually, and what, you know, is essentially bile being spouted in the pulpit, which whips up the congregations, they pour out, and they take it out on anyone that is in their path, Christians, Shia, whatever. And it's that, if we're looking, you know, within the Islamic community, it's the poisonous preachers that need to be dealt with. I do not understand why these people are allowed into Europe, unvetted often, to preach in the mosques. They're causing problems within the Muslim community, but between the Muslim community and the host European communities. These people need to be dealt with, frankly.
I think what the native people, if you like, of host countries desperately want to see is strong, unequivocal condemnation of these acts of terrorism from leaders within the Islamic community. Every time this happens, we want the Grand Mufti of Australia to stand up and say in absolute terms, look, this is horrible, we sympathise with the victims, we will do everything we can to root this out of our community. Instead, what we hear is this guy stand up there and talk in Arabic for 20 minutes and be translated, which doesn't give us a lot of reassurance or confidence. So yes, definitely, please. It is up to, you know, I think wanted to really make this point, as several people have, that Islam is a religion of peace and that this is an aberration. Well, let's hear that loud and clear in absolute unequivocal terms from Islamic leaders in the Western world. We're not hearing it at the moment.